Harper Teen and Harper Audio present Magic Has No Borders, edited by Sona, Charaipotra, and Samira Ahmed, performed by Anil, Margsahayam, and Reena Dutt. To the ancestors who fought for us to be free, to the ones who marched to the sea, and to the ones who fashioned us wings and told us we could fly. Inqilab Zindabad. And to T, L, and N, always and forever, Samira Ahmed. To those who came before, crossing borders and oceans, may your stories come to light. And to those who came after, lifting their voices to share our kahanis. And to Shayar, Kavya, and all the brown kids who finally get to write themselves into the narrative. Sona Charaipotra. Dear reader, it is not lost on me that as I write this note for this gorgeous anthology that Sona Charaipotra and I dreamed up years ago, one of South Asia's greatest writers, Salman Rushdie, is lying in a hospital after being brutally attacked for his words. I remember meeting Rushdie in New York and hearing him talk about how poetry and stories cannot stop bullets or bombs, but they can tell the truth. I am also thinking about how I write this on the eve of the 75th anniversary of India and Pakistani independence, when the yoke of British tyranny over the subcontinent was at last thrown off. Not peacefully, as so many textbooks wrongly claim, but through the violence of partition. A violence deeply shaped and cultivated by British colonial policies, ones that sought to divide, to sow sectarian conflict, in order to ease an exit for the British. Conquerors always want to get off scot-free, don't they? The British hastily drew up articles of separation, a haphazard division of nations that ripped families apart. We still deeply feel those fissures today. Despite Muslims mostly being forced to migrate to Pakistan, my own immediate family chose to stay in India. My nani, my mother's mother, firmly planted her feet on Bombay soil, refusing to leave. She was born in India, she said, and so she would die in India. And she did. Stubborn to the end. However, that decision also came with a high cost. Half our Muslim family migrated to Pakistan, and with the ongoing hostilities between the newly formed nations, my grandmother was never able to see some of her family again. My dad's side of the family lived in Hyderabad, an independent princely state that was never formally under British rule. About one-third of India prior to 1947 was never ruled by the British. This includes the area of Jammu and Kashmir, an area of continued heartbreaking conflict. Hyderabad briefly maintained its independence during and after partition, so my family stayed. My dada, my father's father, had to go into hiding to escape first British troops and then Indian ones as India's new government forcibly annexed Hyderabad under Operation Polo. Why am I referencing so much personal, sectarian, and state violence and colonialism as I speak to what inspired this anthology of diverse voices from across the subcontinent? Simply put, those divisive forces unfortunately shaped and shifted much of the post-1947 diaspora experience, but they do not define who we are. Those hostile dynamics don't speak to the subcontinent's brilliant and beautiful diversity, often erased by colonial rulers and political parties that seek to foment division and rancor where none need exist. Like my nani, I was born in India to a Muslim family that had been there for countless generations, and I won't let anyone take that away from me. Nor will I let any exclusionary power decide how Desi is defined, a term rooted in the word for country, nation. I believe that word should be inclusive, regardless of religion or tribe, ethnicity or class, or caste or gender. As individuals whose ancestors share a common geography, if not always a language or tradition, we get to define ourselves. That's the spirit behind this anthology. We are a people unified without borders, but filled with the songs and tales that hum in our bones. We are a global family that lives not merely in harmony, but in melody. For this anthology, Sona and I brought together a diverse group of Desi authors who represent different regions and cultures and experiences to breathe new life into stories handed down through generations, to add a unique spin to characters both familiar and new. I'm so proud of the work of our contributors, each one of them a shining jewel, not in the crown of an oppressor, but in the endless treasure trove that is the South Asian diaspora experience. Salam, Shanti, Peace. Samira Ahmed. Dear reader, as a small brown girl growing up in the heart of central New Jersey in the 1990s, I was an avid reader. I was absolutely shattered by the loss of my new friend on the way to Terabithia. I started a babysitter's club with my neighborhood pals. I reveled in creating stories out in Idlewild with Anne and Diana. I suffered through long, brutal New England winters with the March sisters. I even swooned over a pair of brooding vampire brothers from Fell's Church. But as much as I read, voraciously, delightedly, I rarely ever found myself or anyone who looked like me in the pages of my favorite books. And it was not until I was much older, in college actually, that I even realized I was missing from the stories I loved so dearly. But once I noticed it, I couldn't unsee it. Brown kids like me, the ones who wore sneakers with their salwar kameez and felt just as awkward at the eighth grade dance as they did at the Gurdwara on Sundays, were nowhere to be found on the page or the screen. And we certainly weren't out there saving the world like Ms. Marvel, who's from Jersey, like me. Nearly 20 years later, as a new parent, I was shocked to realize that things remained so much the same, and that if writers like me didn't do something about it, my own little readers would live through that same shock. The hurt that brought was deep and profound. In fact, when my co-editor Samira Ahmed and I first dreamed up this anthology 5 years ago, we could still count the number of South Asian voices in YA publishing on two hands. Now, with efforts from We Need Diverse Books and other organizations, things have finally begun to change. There are more of us writing and telling stories, and my kids do finally get to see reflections of themselves on the page. And in this anthology, featuring some truly amazing voices, readers will get to dive headfirst into South Asian myth and legend and lore, reimagined by writers from across the breadth and depth of the South Asian diaspora. Stories a kid like me could never even have begun to imagine growing up. I hope you love them as much as I do. Thank you for reading. Sona Charaipotra. Kiss Me Goodbye by Tracey Baptiste. A goddess should not have to do her own assassinations, but if you want something done correctly, better do it yourself. So here we are again, for maybe the thousandth time. I say maybe because I stopped counting after about the 300th reincarnation. A lot of them are a blur, but it always plays out pretty much the same. I awaken to a new life and a new body, just in time to figure out who the target is, find all the traps that have been laid, foil them, kill the guy, and then go back to sleep until the next time the world forgets who I am. It's the forgetting I can't stand. The whole point of being a goddess is the active worship. People need to remember and pay me my due respect. Sometimes that means I need to remind them by taking a life. It's honor me or be killed. Simple. If people didn't forget, we wouldn't have to play this out over and over again, would we? So whose fault is that, huh? I refuse to be forgotten, to fall into the undignified realm of myth and legend, or worse, superhero action movies. Shudder. Meanwhile, this host body is a little, let's say, feisty. I can feel her fighting me, trying to regain control. Frankly, it's sapping my energy and hella irritating. But it's also what made her a good host in the first place. Don't worry, little host. You'll have your body back as soon as I'm done with my mission. It'll ruin your life, sure. But what's one human life when we're talking about the needs of a goddess? Shh.
Kala? Kala, are you listening?
It's my mother. This girl's mother. It always takes a few hours to get used to the host's name.
Yes, ma,
I say.
I asked what time I'm picking you up today.
I catch a glimpse of myself in the sun shield mirror. I've clearly just rolled out of bed. My dark curls are a mess and my eyes are still puffy.
Don't you have rehearsal?
Right, I tell Kalaz, my mother. That.
So?
I squeeze the memory out of the host. 6:30. We'll be done by then. And with any luck, so will I. It's great when things are smooth. I figure out which host body has Lakhinder. I find the best and most efficient way to execute him. I'm out of the host before anyone realizes what's happened. I'm usually long gone before the confusion sets in and the questions begin. Why did this happen? Why would they do this? They were always so quiet, so friendly. No one saw this coming. But sometimes I stick around long enough for someone to remember my name. They say, Manasa. And suddenly they all know who I am, and they understand that these deaths are a consequence of their forgetfulness. They promise to always remember. And then?
Well, get going then,
my mother says.
You'll be late.
I get out of the car, pull my backpack on, and head into the school building. I have never been a high school student before. In New Jersey, no less. Once I was in New Orleans during Prohibition. Now that was a good time. America in the 1920s was also great for fashion. I look down at the ripped jeans and crop top I'm wearing. It's no beaded flapper dress, but a lot more comfortable than most things I've had to put on. I lose myself in the stream of students headed to class. They're mostly much taller than me. Every single time, I hope I'll find myself in the body of someone tall. But I'm an Indian woman. We're on the shorter side. Facts. At the lockers, a girl with a bright orange stripe of hair waves at me. Hey, Nicole. I pull out the combination lock and fiddle with it. Nicole rolls her eyes.
Seriously? You're going to stand there like everybody isn't waiting to hear what happened yesterday?
I look around the hallway. Nobody seems to be waiting for anything.
What? The hell happened with Marcus?
As I pull out my stuff for chemistry, math, and world literature, I evaluate potential weapons. Binder rings, a clicky pen, a dull pencil. Not stellar choices.
Nothing, I say.
She shoves her phone in my face. It takes me a second to adjust my eyes so I can read all the text messages. The one next to her perfectly manicured thumb reads, "She kicked his ass." I snort.
I don't kick, and he doesn't have much of an ass. You're saying there wasn't a whole fight?
I show her my hand.
I didn't even bruise myself. It was one hit. Heel of my hand to his nose. He went down. It was over.
Her laugh surprises the kids closest to us, but only for a moment.
Want me to do damage control?
The damage has been controlled already, I say, and hold up both fists.
My hosts tend to be a little on the violent side, hot-tempered, quick to react. It makes things easier for me to have a little rage to draw from, but also to have someone who already knows how to land a blow. But I've never had a host who was so thoroughly nonchalant about it. There's usually some adrenaline, a rush of dopamine, but not this girl. I could not have picked a better host.
Damn, Nicole says. You are cold.
I shrug. She grins.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.